Harper Audio presents SAS Operation Samarkand Hijack by David Monnery, read by Joseph Balderrama. Prologue. Bradford, England, 14th March 1979. It was a Wednesday evening, and Martin could hear the Coronation Street theme music through the wall. His mother was in the back room, ready to watch. But he had not been allowed to join her, allegedly because he had homework to finish. The real reason, though, was that there was a sex scandal going on. One of the characters was sleeping with another one's wife, or something like that. His mother didn't like any of her children watching such things, and certainly not Martin, who at 12 was the youngest of the three. He continued drawing the blue border around the coastline of England with the felt-tip pen. He liked drawing maps, and he was good at it, both as a copyist and from memory. England, though, was always something of a challenge. It was so easy to make the fat peninsulas too thin and vice versa. The coastline was finished, and he stopped for a moment. It was dark outside now, so he walked over to draw the curtains across the front windows. The sound of raucous laughter floated down the street. It was probably the youths with the motorbikes who habitually gathered outside the fish and chip shop. Thinking about the latter made Martin feel hungry, even though he'd only had supper an hour or so earlier. His father, brother, and sister would be getting chips on their way home from the game, like they always did. But by the time they came through the front door, the only thing left would be the smell on their hands. It was no fun being the youngest. Still, next season he would be able to go with them to the evening games. His father had promised. Martin stood by the table for a moment, wondering whether to ask his mother again whether he could watch TV with her. But she would only say no, and anyway, he didn't really want to. It was not being allowed that was so annoying. He sat back down with his map and started putting in red dots where all the First Division teams played. He had just put in one for Norwich when there was a knock on the front door. He hesitated in the doorway to the hall, but there was no sign of his mother coming out. It was probably only one of those political canvassers in any case, and Martin enjoyed telling them what he had once heard his father say. "A secret ballot should be just that." He walked towards the door, noticing the shadow through the leaded glass, and pulled it open. Almost immediately a foot pushed it back, and Martin himself was propelled backwards into the hall. He had a momentary glimpse of a helmeted figure silhouetted against the starry sky before something flew over his head and exploded into flames in the hall behind him. It all happened so fast.
"Burn, you packy bastards!"
The words seemed to echo down the street as the attacker scrambled back down the path and disappeared into the darkness. Martin turned to find a sheet of flame where his mother's wall hangings from home had been, and fire already spreading up the carpeted stairway. Then a sudden draft fanned the flames and he heard a scream. He started forward, but the heat from the flames threw him back, the smell of singed hair in his nostrils. His mind told him his mother could get out of the window into the back garden, while his heart told him she needed him. But now the flames were forcing him back towards the front door, and he knew that to try to run through them would be suicide. He backed into the front garden, and then spun round and raced next door, where he banged the polished iron knocker like a madman.
"What the blazes?"
Mr. Castle said as he opened the door.
"There's a fire," Martin screamed at him. "Our house is on fire, Mum's inside."
Mr. Castle advanced two steps down the path and saw the light from the flames dancing in the porch.
"I'll ring 999,
he said, and disappeared back inside, leaving Martin in a paroxysm of indecision. Then inspiration struck. He ran back out to the street, past their house and the other neighbours, to where the passage ran through to the allotments. At the end of his own garden, he clambered over the rickety fence and ran to the back of the burning house. The kitchen door was closed, and so was the back room window. Inside, there was nothing but fire. In later years, the rest of the evening would come to seem like a blurred sequence of images. The sirens of the fire engines, the people gathered in the street, his father, brother, and sister coming home, the policemen with their bored expressions and stupid questions. But that moment alone in the darkened garden would never lose its sharpness, with the windows full of flames, and the dreadful truth they told. Chapter 1. They were standing on a dry, broken slope. There were no fragments of masonry to be seen, no shards of tile or pottery, but the configuration of land, the angular ditches, and the flattened hillocks all suggested human occupation. This was the southern end of the original Afrasiab, Nasruddin Sali told the tour party, which became Marakanda, and eventually Samarkand. It was razed to the ground in 1220 by the army of Genghis Khan. Only a quarter of the population, about 100,000 people, survived. It was another 1.5 centuries before Tamerlane revived the city and made it the centre of his empire. These buildings here... Nasruddin indicated the line of domed mausoleums which gracefully climbed the desolate hillside, were probably the finest architectural achievement of Tamerlane's time.
Bloody incredible, Mike Copley murmured, holding up his exposure meter.
It was, Jamie Docherty thought. The blue domes rose out of the yellow-brown hill like articles of faith, like offerings to God, which the donors knew were too beautiful to be refused. Shahi Zinda means the living king, Nasruddin was explaining. This complex was built by Tamerlane to honor Qutam ibn Abbas, who was a cousin of the Prophet Muhammad and one of the men most responsible for bringing Islam to this area. He was praying in a shady spot on this hill when a group of Zoroastrians attacked and beheaded him. Qutam finished his prayer. Nasruddin acknowledged the laughter with a slight smile, picked up his head and jumped into a nearby well. He has lived there ever since, ready to defend Islam against its enemies. The guide smiled again, but there was something else in his expression, something which Docherty had noticed several times that morning. The British-born Pakistani had been with them since their departure from Heathrow 6 days before, and for the first few days of the tour had seemed all affability. But over the last 24 hours, he had seemed increasingly under some sort of strain. The tour party was moving away down the path which led to the Shahi Zinda's entrance gate. As usual, Charles Ogley was talking to, or rather at, Nasruddin, probably telling the guide he'd made yet another historical mistake, Doherty thought sourly. The lecturer from Leeds seemed unable to last an hour without correcting someone about something. His lecturer wife, Elizabeth, was the most frequent recipient of such helpfulness, but seemed to thrive on it, using it to feed some reservoir of bitterness within her soul. They were not an attractive couple, Doherty had decided before the tour's first day had ended. Fortunately, they were only two members of the party for whom he felt any dislike. He banished the Oglies from his mind and focused his attention on the magical panorama laid out before him.
I think you'd take photographs with your eyes,
his wife said, taking an arm and breaking into his reverie.
Aye, Docherty agreed.
It saves on film.
Isabel smiled at the idea and for the 100th time felt pleased that they had come on this trip. She was enjoying it enormously herself, particularly since phoning the children and setting her mind at rest the night before. And he was loving it. They caught up with the rest of the party at the foot of the hill and waited by the archway which marked the entrance to the complex of buildings while Nasruddin arranged their collective ticket with the man in the booth. Then their guide in the lead, the party started climbing the 36 steps which led up past one double-domed mausoleum towards the entrance gate of another. This is called the Stairway to Heaven, Nasruddin said. Pilgrims count each step, and if they lose count, they have to start again at the bottom. Otherwise, they don't go to heaven.
I wonder if this is where Led Zeppelin got the song title from,
Mike Copley mused out loud.
Idiot,
his wife Sharon said. At the top of the stairway, they passed through an archway and into the sunken alley which ran along between the mausoleums. Here,
The restoration work seemed to be only just beginning, and the domes were bare of tiles, the walls patchy, with swathes of mosaic giving way to expanses and underlying buff-coloured brick. At the end of the alley, they gathered around the intricately carved elm door of Kutam's shrine, and Nasruddin pointed out where the craftsman had signed his name and written the year 1405. Inside the Muslim saint's multi-tiered cenotaph was a riot of floral and geometric design. Docherty stood, staring at it for several minutes, wondering why he always felt so moved by Islamic architecture. He had first fallen in love with the domes and mosaics in Amman, where he had served with the SAS during the latter years of the Darfur Rebellion. A near fluency in Arabic had been one legacy of that experience, and in succeeding years he managed to visit Morocco and Egypt. His final mission for the SAS, undertaking the first weeks of the previous year, had taken him to Bosnia, and the wanton destruction of the country's Islamic heritage had been one of the several reasons offered by that war for giving up on the human race altogether. Not to worry, he thought. After all, Kutam was down there in his well, taking care of business. He looked up to find that once again, the tour party had left him behind. Docherty smiled to himself and walked back out into the shadowed courtyard, from where he could see the rest of the party strolling away down the sunken alley. Isabel, her black hair shining in the sun above the bright red dress, was talking to Sam Jennings. The silver-haired American didn't walk that gracefully, but at 75, his mind was as young as anyone's in the tour party. Both Docherty and Isabel had taken a liking to him, and his wife Alice from the first day. Their small bus was waiting for them outside the entrance. It had six double seats on one side and six single on the other, and a four-person seat at the back. Despite there being only 14 in the party, 15 counting Nasruddin, the four Bradford Pakistanis usually sat in a tightly bunched row on the rear seat, as if fearful of being contaminated by their infidel companions. This time, though, one of the two boys, Imran, he thought, was sitting with Sarah Holcroft, or Sarah Jones, to use the name she had adopted for this trip. Docherty wondered if Imran had recognized her as the British Foreign Minister's daughter. He hadn't himself, though the girl had made no attempt to disguise her appearance, and her picture had been in the papers often enough. Isabel had, and so, if their behavior was anything to go by, had both the Copleys and the Oglies. Brenda Walker, the social worker who usually sat with Sarah, was now sitting directly behind her. Docherty had his suspicions about Brenda, and very much doubted whether she was the social worker she claimed to be. He had come into fairly frequent contact with the intelligence services during his years in the army, and thought he knew an official minder when he saw one. But he hadn't said anything to anyone else, not even Isabel. He might be wrong. And in any case, why spoil the generally good atmosphere that existed within the touring party? He wasn't even sure whether Sarah herself was aware of her roommate's real identity.
"Enjoying yourself?"
Isabel asked, leaning forward from her seat directly behind his and putting her chin on his shoulder.
"Never better," he said.
"We seem to go from one wonder of the world to another."
The driver started the bus, and they were soon driving back through the old city, up Tashkent Street, and past the ruined Bibi Khanum Mosque and the Registan assemblage of madrasas, or Muslim colleges, both of which they had visited the previous afternoon. It was almost 12:30 when they reached the cool lobby of the Hotel Samarkand. "Lunch will be in 5 minutes," Nasruddin told them, "and we shall be leaving for Shakrizabs at 1:30. While Isabel went up to their room, Docherty bought a stamp and a postcard from the post office on the ground floor, and then took another look at the Afghan carpets in the hotel shop. They weren't quite attractive enough to overcome his lifetime's hatred of having something to carry. In the largely empty dining room, 14 places had been set on either side of a single long table. The four Bradford Pakistanis had already claimed the four seats at one end. As usual, they were keeping as separate as civility allowed. The two older men flashed polite smiles at Docherty as he sat down in the middle of the other empty places. On the first day, he had made an effort to talk to them and discovered that the two older men were brothers, the two younger ones their respective sons. Zahid was the family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.